let there be light. And there was light. Come on, Jesus. Man, there's something, there's a newness in the air. I know we're in a new year, but there's just something feels new, doesn't it? If it doesn't feel new to you yet, it will be out by the end of the night. And so we just want to start off, honestly, where we start each and every day. This is the day. Amen? The Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Rejoice. You know what rejoice means? It means do it again. In other words, there's some things that you might have praised the Lord for in times past, but you just need to do it again. I got under this thing yesterday that I pray that I never come out of, but I've been like in this two-day bubble of grace for intercession, and it came just by starting to thank God for what He's done over the past year. And the more I began to thank the Lord, all of a sudden I was in travail, balled up under my desk for like 4 hours, just like screaming in tongues and just like, and I mean like, and it was almost like the Holy Spirit just began to take over and began to intercede in thanksgiving for what He had done and beginning to prophesy into what He's about to do. But listen, I'm telling you right now, we're in a season where it's time to rejoice. It's time to do it again, to thank God again. And so listen, if you've got something to be thankful for, I want to tell you to get up out of your seat, get up on your feet. Come on now. The sacrifice of praise. The sacrifice of praise. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank You. God, we thank You. We thank You. We thank You. Oh, and then we thank You. We thank You. We thank You. We thank You. And then we thank You, God. We thank You for Your faithfulness. You're worthy. We thank You, God. Come on. We thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You for the blood. Thank You for the Holy Spirit. Thank You for Your Son, God. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Thank You for saving us from the pit. Thank You for delivering us from the miry clay and setting our feet upon the rock. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
I want to scream it out from every mountain top. Your goodness knows no bounds. Your goodness never stops. Your mercy follows me. Your kindness fills my mind. Your love.
Full of faith declare, and our song, it will
generation with resurrection life. We are a generation filled with the power of Christ, and our song, it will be out of the darkness. We will
He is free.
is hope, joy, love, peace, life, forever and ever. Everything we need. Who is everything that we need? He is everything that we need. Of your presence, I find rest for my soul, and in the depths of your love, I find.
Soul. And in the day.
find peace. It makes me whole. What's telling you not my love? And I love my love. I love your presence. And I love my love. I love your presence. And I love my love. Oh, I love you, Jesus. I love my love. Gotta let go of your heart, let go of your head now, and feel, oh, come and feel him tonight. Let go of your heart, let go of your head, and feel him now, yeah, yeah. Oh, he's close tonight. He's closer than your skin. Oh, he's close tonight. talks with me and he tells me that I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. When he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me that I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, oh, none other has ever known. When I come to the garden, when I come into the secret place,
we'll be right back.
Say tonight that wherever you want to take us, we want to go. Take us deeper. Take us further. Only in God can go deeper and higher at the same time. Now, this is the Day of Atonement. It's the Day of Restoration. And the English word atonement, and I know about Christ being our atonement and propitiation for our sins and all. Let's pull back from the theology for a minute and look at the history of the language. The word atonement means to be, it simply means at-one-ment, at-one-ment. It's the at-one-ment. It means to be one with. Because of this great love with which He's loved us, because God so loved that He gave His Son, that whosoever should believe upon Him would not perish but have eternal life, not just going to heaven when you die, but knowing the Father and the Son whom He has sent. Having heaven and earth fellowship with God. That's what today is about. It's a day to celebrate the blood and not to look at your sin. It's a day to celebrate the blood and enter in. Because there's a new and a living way that has been made for each and every one of us. The veil has been torn. He's inviting us to come near, to feel His breath on our face. Jesus, just ruminate that in your heart for a moment. At one moment, oneness with God. God and man, man and God. It was the original plan in the garden. And the Father said to the Son and the Spirit, He said, let us make man in our image. And He began to piece together out of the dust of the earth this frame of a man. And then He breathed in him. And as the man inhaled and exhaled, he was looking right into the face of God. And that's what this day is all about. It's a day to exhale the pain of where you've been and to inhale the promise of where he's taking you. Oh gosh. Shema. Shema namaseke. Jesus. Emmanuel. Emmanuel. God with us. God with us. So often we talk about looking back when, man, the presence of God was so rich, and or looking forward into what might be coming. And we miss out on celebrating the here-ness of God. Always looking for the nearness and never celebrating the here-ness. God is in our midst. Breathing. Walking. Talk. Looking for willing vessels that would simply inhale the goodness of God. And with every exhale, let go of the disappointment of your past. Today is a day. Promotion, but it's not by your power, it's not by your might, but it is by my spirit, says the Lord. Not because of what you've done, but because of what the blood has done for you. There's power in the blood. Oh, there's power. Just one drop. Plan to receive communion during the offering, but we're going to call an audible because he is. And if the folks who are helping to bring the communion out, if you guys could go get that, and we're going to receive communion right now in remembrance of the Lord. Remembrance of what he's done, in honor of what he's doing, and an expectancy of what he's promised to do. One minute, to be at one with God. No longer man crying out to God, but God crying out through man. Oh, it's a No longer sinners searching for grace, but sons beholding his face. Thank you. I want to invite you just to come forward and take of the blood and take of the body. And we're going to take it together in celebration of something, but I just, man, there's something holy. That one man. You see, we're not just receiving communion tonight and in need. We're receiving communion tonight from a place of revelation and abundance. From a place of celebration. At one minute. One with God. Those of you who are watching by way of the web, I just encourage you to join us in this. Go to your fridge, get some grape juice or just whatever you have on hand. I want to tell you, listen, the Lord doesn't need Welch's and Ritz to show up. I remember one time, our children have never had chicken pox. They had an opportunity to one time. You remember this? Caleb, all of a sudden, he came to us, and it was just like instant, pop. Like, it wasn't just one bump. It was, like, all bumps. And so we, you know, of course, you go into natural parent mode. Well, you know, now all the kids are going to get it. And, well, it's better that they have it now and not later. You start to reason, and you start to justify, right? But this is what he said. He says, can we come and do the body and the blood? He was, like, what, 6 or 7 or... But how old? About 6 or 7. I said, can we come and do the body and the blood? I'm like, a child shall lead them. The faith, amen. And all we had was some V8 fusion. And what kind of cracker? It was a fun cracker. It was an awesome cracker. It was no oyster cracker. It was an awesome cracker. These are awesome too. But we poured that V8 fusion, and we took that cracker, and we blessed it. We broke it, and we began to celebrate the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. We began to celebrate that his body was broken, that ours wouldn't have to be. And as we took of the blood and we took of the body, right there before our eyes, every bump disappeared. Every sign of chickenpox left his body. You know, and I'm just telling you, listen, we settle for what the world throws at us too easy. Amen? So today, on the Day of Atonement, as the Day of Atonement comes to an end at sundown, this is a day to be restored. It's a day to put all past sins under the blood of the Lamb and to be fully restored to God and to his purposes. It's not a time to focus on your sin, but it is a time to focus on the blood. We've just come through the 10 days of awe where we were asking the Lord, saying, Lord, is there any area in my life that I've gotten off track, any area that I've allowed a hindrance to get in that is hindering my fellowship with you, that is distracting me from beholding you with an unveiled face and seeking you with my whole heart. But the message of atonement, at one man, say at one man, oneness with God. The message of atonement is to say to you that there is nothing from your past that can hold back your present and rob you of your future. Let's take the blood.
I'm going to say that again because it's awesome, isn't it, Sarah? Come on.
The message of atonement is to say that there is nothing. Say this with me. Say, there is nothing from my past that can hold back what God is doing in my present to bring me into the wonderful future that he has laid hold of for me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we receive the work of your blood tonight. We celebrate the work of your blood. And we thank you for oneness with God. In Jesus' name. And take the body. Jesus. Father, as we partake of this bread tonight, Father, I speak healing to everybody here that needs it. If you need healing in your body right now, just raise the cracker. I was going to say when I read that, I'll drink to that, but I didn't want anybody to get offended, but I'm telling you, that's a good toast. Amen. Nothing from your past can hold back your present from what God wants released in your future. But here's what I want you to do. I want you just to hold up this cracker, hold up the body, and say with me, say, Lord, your body was broken. Your body was beaten. You bore the stripes of my healing on your back. Your body was broken that my body could be made whole. Father, in the name of Jesus, I receive healing bread. You said that healing is the children's bread, and I come to you like a child to partake of your healing for my life. In Jesus' name, amen. That's a good oyster. That's a good cracker. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. What are you feeling, Jeff? Just shake your hand off.
Jesus.
just forgiven, you're cleansed. You're clean. Come on. Power in the blood. You've been granted a pardon. You've been reconciled with and reconciled to God. To be made at one with God. Father, I thank you that you're answering Jesus' prayer that we would be one. As you and the Father are one. That we would be one in you, one through you. That with the same glory that the Father gave to you, you would give to us. You say, but wait a minute. Didn't he say that he wouldn't give his glory to another? Well, that's true. But number one, the Hebrew word for another is one who would be slack or procrastinate or would not value the gift they've been given. And secondly, you're not another. You're bone of his bone. You're flesh of his flesh. You are his body. In fact, in that same passage where people say God won't give his glory to another, God won't give his praise to another. But if you back up a few verses in verse 7, Isaiah 43, verse 7, it says, behold, everyone I have created, I have formed them for my glory. In other words, just like he put Adam together out of the dust of the earth and breathed the breath, he created you for the glory. He created you for the glory. Oh, there's power. The precious blood. Jesus. Can we sing, oh, what a friend we have in Jesus? I may have just done a key change. But at least it isn't Mary, did you know? That's coming for the offering.
Friend we have in Jesus.
Our sins and griefs to bear.
Oh, a privilege to carry
everything to God in prayer.
See, what a friend.
Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer.
I'm telling you, there's a fellowship that Jesus is bringing us into. To where we no longer carry the heaviness that this world would try to put on us. But as we walk in oneness with God, he begins to take the yoke. He begins to take the burden. And what I just saw in my heart was a group of people. It was a large group of people sitting at a table having dinner. It was a wonderful meal, and all of a sudden the bill showed up. Now, sometimes when the bill shows up, people wrestle over who gets it. Sometimes people wrestle over who don't get it. You ever notice who goes to the bathroom at the end of the meal? You always got to watch those folks. But I just saw the Lord just reach out his hand. I didn't see his face. I saw his hand, and he said, I'll take that. I want to tell you, he's prepared a table in the presence of your enemies, and everything has been paid for. Every debt has been canceled. Every debt. You don't owe the past anything, but you owe the future everything, because he's going to receive the reward of his sufferings. Amen? And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, God, I thank you, Lord, that in celebration of the Day of Atonement, a day of restoration, God, Lord, that you are speaking to the heart of a people in Birmingham, Alabama, that we are one with God. That we are one with God. celebrate that by the power of your blood and the beauty of your name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Tell you, there's such a fellowship to be had with Jesus. Such a fellowship, not to just relegate our worship or our time with the Lord for a devotional window in the morning or a service in the Wednesday night, Friday night, Sunday morning. We may just try to have services all the time just to keep us in a place of praise. No, I'm just kidding. But listen, I'm telling you, there's a friendship. There's a fellowship that God is desiring to have. And I want to tell you right now, each and every one of us can get just as close to God as we want to. Isn't that awesome? In fact, what if we had a divine competition to see over the next year who could get closer to God? I started yesterday. I've got a head start. What if we just started living our life to know God? And to walk more intimately with him each and every day. Not that we want to walk more closely than them, but just saying, God, Lord, every day I want to walk closer with you than I did yesterday. And tomorrow, I'm going to walk even closer. Because the Holy Spirit is looking for a people to overshadow. You stand under the shadow. But we want to be those who stand by the Lord, who walk with you in the cool of the day. In Jesus' name. Jesus. Let's have the kids come on down. Jesus. Holy Spirit, I love you, Holy Spirit, I love you, Holy Spirit, Jesus. Father, thank you for what you're going to do tonight with King's Kids. God, thank you for the message that you've given to Tina. And God, we ask for the spirit of wisdom and revelation to be poured out upon these arrows in the quiver, in Jesus' name. I also want to remind you, of course, we have simulcast in our nursery for nursing moms. And, of course, we have the nursery staff tonight as well. If you have children, some of that face plant salvation. You know, 1 Corinthians 14, it says, when one walks into your prophesying, they'll fall on their face and say, truly God is among you. So Megan just walked that out for us. A face plant salvation. Amen. I'm just going to read you something real quick. I've been eating this book, Spiritual Hunger, and I'm going to read a little bit from it tonight, but I want to read this to you real quick. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. This is, by the way, this is a mini collection of some of John G. Lake's sermons, and Spiritual Hunger just always had awakened something in me. It was when I was reading yesterday morning when all of a sudden this grace to pray, honestly, like I've never prayed, came on me, and I got hungrier than I've ever been. And I got news for you. It's just increasing. He said, speaking of spiritual hunger, I wish we all had it spiritually. I'll go ahead and back up. Hunger can be a good thing. It's the greatest persuader I know of. It is a marvelous power. Nations have learned that you can do almost anything with a populace until they get hungry. But when they get hungry, watch out. There is a certain spirit of desperation that accompanies hunger. I wish we all had it spiritually. I wish we were desperately hungry for God. Wouldn't it be glorious? It would be a strange thing if we all got desperately hungry for God. It would be a strange thing if we were all desperately hungry for God if only one or two got filled in a service. In other words, he was saying that to the extent we hunger and thirst is the extent that we're filled. He said, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. Righteousness is the rightness of God. The rightness of God in your spirit, the rightness of God in your soul, the rightness of God in your body, the rightness of God in your affairs, in your home, in your business, everywhere. God is an all-around God. And what I feel in the room right now is rightness. I'm not even sure that's a word. But I know it's what I feel. There's things that have been off kilter that all of a sudden are standing upright. It's like the plumb line. This morning I was on the phone with a friend of ours, Dan Moeller, and we were just talking about possible dates for him to come back and to be with us. And I love Dan. And he's like, Brother Jason, why do you think the Lord would want me to come back? You know, I typically don't go anyplace twice, and you know, there's just so many hungry folks out there. And I said, well, it's a good question. I said, honestly, I said, I just feel like so much of what you carry is the DNA of what God has given us to walk in, and I feel like there's a plumb line in your life and a steady hand that comes on the rudder, and it's not that our ship's off course. I said, it's just, there's just this steady diet of just the gospel and what it is, and just that reminder that it's not about us. It's about our love for Jesus, and that causes us to live a life of love to others. See, because I had a dream about Dan, and Tina was in it too, because we were giving birth. We're in the delivery room. And Dan was in there with us. And if you know Dan, typically just smiling all the time, and you know, but it wasn't a smile. He was laughing uncontrollably and crying in celebration of what God was releasing and birthing. And I told him the dream. He said, well, I'm going to pray. He said, because I sure would just like to come see you guys. And he said, it's going to be a yes unless the Lord tells me no for some reason. He said, but because, you know, he said, I love Jeff and Suzanne, and I love the King's Way, and I love staying with you and Tina. He's like, I just fall so in love with y'all's heart. He said, but honestly, he said, you need to know. He said, I go all around, I go all these different churches, and I don't speak fluff. If you know Dan, he's not a fluff speaker. He said, but honestly, he said, you guys, like, you have it. He's like, it's not just the message, but it's what God is wanting to birth. It's here. Like, in other words, I think a lot of times we just look for somebody from the outside in to come and bring us something we don't have. Instead of somebody from the outside in coming in and just being like, listen, what God is doing here is special. Makes me think of that call you got from Louisiana today. You know? Friend of the house in Louisiana called, and he said, man, he said, I'm just trying to work out my schedule to where I can drive on a Friday night. I'm sure he's watching now. Leon Emery, we love you, Leon. Leon the Lion. He said, I just wish I could tell everybody in Birmingham what God is doing in Birmingham. He's like, because I'm not sure they really understand what God is doing in Birmingham. He said, I have to come from Louisiana. He said, and I'm just trying to work out my schedule to where I can just drive for one service and drive right back.
And actually what he said was,
thank you.
I have to correct him sometimes. It is Birmingham, but
I wasn't on the phone.
Leon actually said, I want to stand before your people and say, I hope you know what you have at Kingsway Church, is actually what he said. And it is in Birmingham, but he said, I want your people, I hope they appreciate. He said, I would drive hundreds of miles to come. And some of those are in the neighborhood, and I just hope they know how awesome they have it.
And he was a guy who was driving hundreds of miles to come pray at 6 o'clock in the morning. They used up their vacation time for the year to come and spend a week praying with us. That's what's getting ready to happen. What if we just start trading in Disney World for heaven on earth? Folks, it's time that we celebrate his here-ness. He's here. He's here. And listen, I know, you know, that all prophets are supposed to prophesy about what's coming, but maybe we're not prophets. Maybe we're just realist. We just say what we see and see what we say. He's here. It's not that he's coming. He's here. He's just waiting for a people to recognize him, to begin to embrace him, and even what looks like infancy, and to be like those three wise men, to travel great distances just to come and worship. Even though he's not a full-grown king, even though he may not even be able to talk, he may not even be able to walk, but having eyes to see the King of glory. God, make us desperate. God, make us hungry. Back guarantee on tonight. Because we can ask for hunger all night long. We can ask for thirst. And oftentimes if there's like a catch or a condition in our heart, God, I want to be thirsty, but I don't want to be like that. I don't want to be thirsty like that person. I don't want to be hungry like that person, God. Can I be hungry and have it all together? Can I be thirsty and still keep up with the Joneses? I'm telling you, I'm just like Pentecost at any cost. God, whatever it is, God, whatever it is that I can offer to you from my life, whether it's more time, more prayer, just more time in the secret place, it's yours. Just put your finger on it and I'll let it go, God. Ooh. We've been in this wonderful place the past, it's not even been 48 hours yet, I guess like 36, you know? Where it's just like, he's here. I mean, just like this awareness of God. And I believe it's available for the taking. I believe it's available for the receiving. And so, if it's in your heart to do so, I'm going to invite you to pray a dangerous prayer. You're going to start praying the prayer before I tell you how it ends up. It's in your heart. I want you to say this with me. God, I'm willing to be hungry again. God, I'm willing to be thirsty again. God, I ask you for the grace of desperation. God, I ask you to grip my heart for the things of God. Give me a love for what is holy. And Lord, I give you permission this night to turn my life upside down. I give you permission tonight to turn my world upside down. come however you want to come. Just come.
Thank you.
Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard.
My heart, I was in prayer in my office, and the Lord said, "You're in a stirrup season." I said, "What's a stirrup season, Lord? What's a stirrup season?" And at first he took me to Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. And this is what it says. It says, "Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength." And that word wait means to be intertwined with, as in becoming one. "Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings." They shall mount up. You're in a stirrup season. You shall mount up with wings like eagles. "They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." And then he took me over to Isaiah chapter 64, because I'm telling you, there's a place in the presence of God. There's a place in fellowship with him to where, honestly, there's an increase of energy. Because when we do what we're doing yoked with Him, we actually do it from His strength and not from ours. And I mean, even when I walked out of my office tonight, I was like, my God, I was like, man, I just wanted like somebody hook up an 18-wheeler to my back. I want to pull it. I mean, I'm just like, ah, like this, there's something in the spirit that God is wanting to give strength to His people. To where the weak, those who've been weak, can say, I'm strong. To where areas that you've been afflicted, you can say, I'm healed. And then He took me over to Isaiah chapter 64. I said, okay, so we're in a stirrup season. And, you know, I was like, you know, with Bob Marley playing in the background, you know, stir it. You know, Isaiah 64, this is the prayer of Isaiah 64. It says, oh, that you would rend the heavens. Oh, that you would rend the heavens, that you would come down. Oh, man, that's a, oh, hey, ha, 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 hey, hey, ha, ha, ha. Oh, that you would rend the heavens, that you would come down, that the mountains might shake at your presence. As fire burns brushwood, as fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, that the nations may tremble at your presence. When you did awesome things for which we did not look, you came down and the mountains shook at your presence. And I said, Lord, what is this? What are you saying? He said, you're coming into the season where I'm about to do things you didn't see coming. Even in the midst of all that you see coming, it says that they said, Lord, you've done things. You did awesome things for which we did not look. In other words, they're like, man, we didn't see that happen. I'm telling you, we're coming into an Ephesians 3:20. He is able to do exceedingly abundantly above what we ask or think. But He says, listen, it starts with you thinking. It starts with you imagining. It starts with you asking. It starts with you giving a voice to what you're called to carry. And then it says, for since the beginning of the world, men have not heard nor perceived by the ear, nor has the eye seen any God besides you who acts for those who wait for Him. You meet Him who rejoices and does righteousness, who remembers you in your ways. But in verse 7, it says, and there is no one who calls on your name, who stirs himself up to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us. And so in other words, the Lord was speaking through the prophet Isaiah, His desire to rend the heavens and come down. To begin to act for those who wait for Him, to meet with those who rejoice and do righteousness and who remember the Lord. It says, you indeed were angry, for we have sinned. In these ways we continue, and we need to be saved. Here's what He was saying. It was a conviction you were talking about on Sunday. He was saying, listen, there's an area in our life that we need to stir up ourselves to take hold of the Lord. And He said, listen, I wanted to come down, but there was no one who was willing to stir themselves up to lay hold of me. And so the Lord began to start speaking of this stirrup season, that it's a season to mount up with wings like eagles, to run and not grow weary, to walk and not faint. It's a season to stir ourselves up, to begin to see God act for those who wait for Him, and to begin to see God meet with those who rejoice in your righteousness. But it's also out of 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6 and 7. Paul speaks to Timothy. He said, hey, Timothy, I remind you to stir it up. Stir up the gift of God which was given you in the laying on of hands. You've not been given a spirit of fear, power. You've not been given a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. And so, folks, I want to tell you, as we begin to transition, we're in a stirrup season. We're in a season, because listen, here's the deal. You're not called to stir things up in and of your own strength. In fact, I'll tell you, that won't work. They've tried it in times past. I've tried it in times past. It'll just leave you worn out and burn out. Amen, Richard? But we're being invited to be a people who would not just wait on the Lord, but wait with the Lord, to be intertwined, to come into at-one-ment with God, that we can begin to run with endurance the race that is set before us and begin to mount up with wings like eagles. To begin to see God do things that we didn't see coming, that were beyond what we thought He desired to do. To see God begin to act in areas where we're waiting. To see God begin to release what he calls open reward in areas we've hidden ourselves in secret. To begin to meet with those who rejoice and do righteousness. Listen, I'm telling you, this rejoicing thing's a lot bigger than just singing a couple songs. It's a lifestyle. We're going to talk about it tonight. The Lord spoke to my heart of this 20 keys out of how to receiving, believing, and birthing prophetic promise in your life. And it starts with rejoicing, but honestly, my heart's so stirred right now. I'm like, Lord, where do you want to go? Jesus. I know we have to receive an offering because we sent all of our money today to buy more meals to feed more hungry people. But I'm asking the Lord for something sovereign tonight. I know it's on me. For something sovereign to come upon you. For Holy Spirit to begin to overshadow each and every one of us the way that he overshadowed Mary. He began to brood over our lives in such a way as to not only impregnate us, but also begin to give us understanding in how to birth what we've been called to carry in this season. But I want to tell you, the sovereign hand of God starts with the willingness to hunger in the heart of man. Turn your Bible to Isaiah chapter 60. I'm going to catch up with you in a moment. I love this quote, again, Spiritual Hunger by John G. Lake. There is nothing more wonderful than the indwelling of God in the human life. The most supreme example that God ever performed was his taking possession of men. By the Holy Spirit, he comes in and takes possession of those who are hungry. Blessed are those which do hunger. I will guarantee to you that after the crucifixion of Jesus, there were 120 mighty hungry folks in Jerusalem. If they had not been exceedingly hungry, they would have not been so gloriously filled. It was because they were hungry that they were filled. We are sometimes inclined to think of God as mechanical, as though God just set a date for this or that event to occur. But my opinion is that one of the works of the Holy Ghost is to prepare the hearts of men in advance by putting within them a strong hunger for that event that has been promised by God until it comes to pass. In other words, the timeline of heaven records things differently than the timeline of earth. Oftentimes, the timeline of earth records the delivery, but the timeline of heaven records the conception. And whether tonight is a night of your conception or a night of your delivery, both are needed. Amen? And as I was praying about how to receive our offering tonight, what the Lord would have us to do, and he took me to Isaiah chapter 60. And I've never received an offering out of this passage, but all of a sudden when I turned to it, it really just started speaking to me. And Isaiah 60, of course, is a passage we're all familiar with. It's the Arise and Shine passage. Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people. But, I love that word, but the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. You know what that means? It means that in the midst of deep darkness, the Lord will begin to rise upon you. We've tried to somehow pull this scripture apart from what it actually means. And I as I was looking at this today, I want to tell you, it means exactly what it says. There's no hidden meaning. There's no this or that, or if this happens, then that can happen. He's saying, listen, arise and shine. In other words, he's saying, do something. He didn't say sit there and wait. And see, in a lot of the churches, a sit and wait service. But we're called to be an arise and shine people, amen? Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people, but the Lord will arise over you. Say, the Lord will arise over me, and his glory will be seen upon me. The Gentiles shall come to my light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes all around and see. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from afar, and your daughters shall be nursed at your side. Then you shall see and become radiant, and your heart shall swell with joy, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you. The wealth of the Gentiles shall come to you. The multitude of camels shall cover your land. The dromedaries of Midian and Ephah, all those from Sheba, shall come. They shall bring gold and incense, and they shall proclaim the praises of the Lord. And the flocks of Kedar shall be gathered together. The rams of Naboth shall minister to you. They shall ascend with acceptance on my altar, and I will glorify the house of my glory. I will glorify the house of my glory. And my prayer is that every home represented here would be a house, a home of his glory, a house of his glory. That this would be a house of his glory. And Isaiah 60 is an invitation to us to do something with what God has given to us. To do something with what God has given to us. You know, as the body of Christ, we really should be the most generous people on the planet. As the body, I'm just going to say it again until we believe it. As the body of Christ, we should be the most generous people on the planet, even if what you have to give looks like two fish and five loaves. Even Jeff and I today, we were getting together and, you know, sending out this check for these, to get these materials for the food and the meal packing. And I said, let's just pray. Like, can we pray over the check? Don't put it in the mailbox. I want to, let's pray over it first. Let's be like the little boy with the two loaves and the fish, bringing it to Jesus. And we had a Holy Ghost prayer time. It just, opened up. And all of a sudden I started to see, wow, God, we're looking to feed those who have natural hunger. God, Lord, as we set our heart and our hand to be able to be a blessing to those who hunger in the natural, Father, in the name of Jesus, would you then send to us those who are hungry in the spirit? Because that's my prayer. Send us the hungry. Send us the thirsty. But Lord, would you give us a people who are ready to arise and are ready to shine, ready to take what God has given to them and begin to allow it to be seen by the world around us. Yes, it says the wealth of the Gentiles will come to us, but we've got to give them something to come to. Are you with me? So if you're making out checks tonight, you can make out to Kingsway Church. If you want to get by cash or credit card, there's envelopes in the seat pocket in front of you. As the body of Christ, we were called, we're created to be the most generous people on the planet. God so loved that he gave. And we so love that we give back. Loving him and giving to him in free will offerings, gifts, tithes, alms were needed, benevolence were needed. But I'm telling you, God is about to do something. Listen, the hungry is about to come into this house. As we're looking to feed the hungry, God says, listen, I'm going to send the spirit, those who are hungry spiritually. And so my prayer is, Lord, as we arise and as we shine, as we continue to shine forth the light that you have given to us, God, we ask that that light be multiplied in and through us. Father, even as we're giving tonight, God, Lord, you said that if we sow bountifully, we would reap bountifully. But if we sow sparingly, we would reap sparingly. Lord, you said that you are able to make all grace abound to us, to give us all sufficiency in all things, to have an abundance for every good work. And Lord, there are so many good works that you have called us to. We need that abundance. Each and every person here, God, Lord, this is in Ephesians 2:10, that you created them in Christ Jesus before time began for good works. They're predestined. Matthew chapter 5 talks about how when men would see our good works, they would give glory to our Father who is in heaven. God, we want to walk out those good works that would cause men to give glory to our Father. And Lord, we recognize that many of those good works cost money. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, as we sow bountifully tonight, we ask you in the name of Jesus to cause your grace to abound to each and every person here. Those who are watching by way of the web, if you're watching by way of the web and want to give tonight, there's a donate button just below the screen. Click that button and give online and be a part of this donate, or a part of this offering. God, we ask for grace. And we ask for abundance. We ask for all sufficiency for every good work. Not so that we could have more stuff, but so that your kingdom could increase and expand. Lord, that we would be a people that would seek to increase our status of giving and not just our status of living. Lord, I thank you, Lord, just as Paul said, that you multiply every seed that is sown and that you increase the fruits of righteousness. And so, Lord, we come to you tonight, thankful for what you've given to us and willingly giving it back to you, just like those three wise men as they came to worship Jesus. All of a sudden, when what had been promised showed up, their gold, all of a sudden it was real easy to let go of their gold when the king came, the frankincense, the myrrh. Lord, give us eyes to recognize in its infancy what you're doing in our midst and to give freely what you've given to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Seated in majesty. Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask you, Holy Spirit, to water in every gift that is given and every seed that is sown, Lord, to multiply the fruit to our account. But Lord, even more than that, Father, we thank you, Lord, that each and every dollar given is like a soldier marching out into the fields of harvest. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we swing open the doors of this house and we say, we call in the hungry, we call in the desperate, we call in the thirsty, we call in the lost, we call in the hurting, in Jesus' name. And Father, we thank you that we're a house of bread and that we'll always have more than enough for those who are hungry. We'll always have more than enough, Jesus. And Lord, that as you come and begin to break bread, Lord, I ask that every eye would be open and every heart would know you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Got video announcement. I'm just not wanting to break count. I'm trying to figure out where we are here. Tell you what, I'm going to give you a 3-minute video announcement and a 5-second plug. We have services Wednesday, Friday, Sunday. Come to all of them.
That's good. Yeah.
And this Saturday, we've got a booth at the Whistle Stop Cafe. Oh, not Whistle Stop Cafe. I got fried green tomatoes on the mind. But at the Whistle Stop Festival. And they're expecting about 7,000 people. The Irondale Whistle Stop Festival, located in historic Irondale. Fireworks in Beacon Park. All kinds of great stuff. And so we've got a booth. We've got where we're going to be offering, of course, dream interpretation, prophetic ministry, spiritual readings, yada, yada, yada. Oh my gosh, they've got bands. They even have the Beavers Brothers. What kind of band is that? 145 to 245, the Beavers Brothers band. Come on now. You must not have heard about our word about the Beavers. But anyway, Lord bless them. But 10 a.m. to 7, is that right, Amy? Of course, our Jesus teams are going to be there, but we're going to have a base that we want to be able to really just love people, speak hope to their heart, pray for healing for those who need it, speak prophetic encouragement, and just to walk around the crowd recognizing who the Lord begins to draw us to, and then beginning to release the kingdom, beginning to release Jesus to those people, okay? And so how many of you say, listen, I was planning to go to a stop anyway, or I would love to be a part of this Saturday? Raise your hand. Awesome. All right, maybe you didn't hear the question. We're going to go give Jesus to our city. If you want to give Jesus to your city, raise your hand. Hey, there we go. Awesome. Hey, Amy is going to be outside after the service in the Connect Center. Is there a sign-up sheet to where they can sign up even if you're not there? In the Connect Center, which is just on the counter of the cafe, we ask you to sign up. We're having two-hour sign-up sheet at the Connect Center. So coming and volunteering for 2 hours, okay? And so what, 10 a.m. to 7, what is that? Shike lebata, 9 hours. So somebody gets to have an extra hour, bless God. But anyway, and so we need folks at the table. We need folks at the booth for folks who are coming up just going, hey, listen, what are you about? Why are you here? You know, and then being able to tell them what they're here for. Being able to speak to the heart of who they are. And then also teams that would like to roam and just go out and just love people. Amen? So it's going to be an awesome time this Saturday, 10 a.m. to 7. Maybe we can just load you guys up even with bottles of water and stuff like that. I know we can't do food because of the health deal, but just something that helps to draw them in. We bless them with those. Amen? So again, how many of you say, listen, I want to be a part of that? Saturday, we'll be talking about it again Friday night. Don't miss this Friday Night Fire. There's a real brewing of the Lord in that service. God, I'm telling you, God's up to something. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Speaking of up to something, I've had butterflies in my tummy I've been burning for 2 days, but I've had butterflies for about a week. And the way that I can describe it is this, is, you know, like how when you're riding a roller coaster and you're like, click, 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 and then all of a sudden you get to that top and it's like, something going to happen. And you're not really sure if it's good or bad. You know what I'm saying? That's kind of the feeling I've got right now. Like, something going to happen. Not sure if it's going to be good or bad. I'm just kidding. But anyway, you're at the top of the roller coaster, and it's all of a sudden beginning to cross that crest. And I have felt in my spirit over the last week that we have crossed the crest, and we're really about to engage what we were created for, you know? This roller coaster of expectancy and adventure. You know, I was praying for a gentleman on the phone this morning, and I kept hearing that song. You know, it's an oldie, but it's a goodie. This is the great adventure. Saddle up those horses. We got a trail to blaze. Amen. You know, mount up. Bam. Come on now. Good old Stephen Curtis Chapman. But how many of you have been just feeling a sense in your spirit that, like, man, something's about to happen? Anybody? Oh, good. Awesome. And see, what's great is when we begin to recognize that and engage that, because that's actually where the move of God starts. Do that again. How many of you has anybody been feeling actually like the butterflies? Any of like that stirring, or just this sense, this overwhelming sense? Again, just show of hands. Look at this. Look around. Isn't that awesome? Praise the Lord. And see, here's what the reason why I'm asking you to do that is because oftentimes in those moments, the enemy tries to isolate you, and that's what he did to Elijah. When Elijah started thinking he was the only one. He was the only one that could hear God, only one that could be used by God, and then the Lord's like, hey, you know, Elijah, I got 7,000 others, you know, cool your jets. And so it's helpful to begin to recognize that we're sensing something that God is beginning to speak corporately. Because when you begin to, when you take hunger and hunger and you put hunger and thirst together, that's where filling comes. Amen? And so you recognize this stirring, you know? Like I said, there's, you know, just been times over the past 2 days that I've just hunkered down in prayer. And honestly, I went into it thinking like, oh man, I'm just gonna have to press in. I'm just gonna give the Lord a couple hours, and I'm just gonna shaka about that until God comes. And literally, I barely got the shaka out, and the Lord just came. I mean, He came. I was on the floor under my desk in a ball, just kumbayakatata bateke. It was amazing, because it wasn't just praying in tongues, but it was prophesying in tongues. And I was looking back, thanking God for what He's brought us out of, what He's brought us through, and then beginning to prophesy into what He's about to do. And it was just this gut-wrenching, like almost tribal deal. And I was like, Lord, do that again. That's some good wine. I want that again. And then all of a sudden, I get here at work today, and I notice a lot more distractions showed up. And I'm like, Lord, maybe everybody doesn't know. This is the Day of Atonement. I need a bubble. I need a bubble. Like, Lord, you know, like, do not disturb sign. You know, folks don't realize there's a do not disturb sign of the Spirit. And so all of a sudden, you know, I begin to recognize there's an invitation to come back in, but also the enemy oftentimes can recognize when we're beginning to start taking momentum. He can't come and speak in the secret place, but he will send a lot of good things to surround us to take us away from God's best. A lot of things that really need your attention in the moment. How many of you know people didn't get into trouble overnight? They can't get out overnight, amen? Come on now. And so oftentimes, I want to encourage you, as you begin to start getting momentum in the Spirit, in your prayer life, I want to encourage you to guard that time. Because two things I want to talk to you about tonight out of Luke chapter 1 is unity and intimacy. Unity and intimacy, and the recipe for birthing. Turn in your Bible to Luke chapter 1. Originally, I was putting together an outline for tonight, and then the Lord said, don't do it. I said, why, Lord? I said, everybody likes the outline. He said, don't engage their head. I want their heart. And I said, oh, katabashaka. Sometimes I do have a Japanese tongue. Shakatabakatabashaka. Hobachi. All right. This, I haven't eaten in a while. That cracker was awesome. Was that not great cracker? Jesus. That was shakatabakete. My buddy. Communion's always sweeter when you haven't eaten for a while, isn't it? Come on now. It's a good cracker. I might need me another swig of grape juice. I'm just kidding. All right. The thing the Lord really was highlighting in my spirit was that we need to be unpacking. How many of you know God, even in our Sunday mornings, as we had that panel with Brother Joe and Jeff and myself, we were talking about releasing the sound for this coming year, 5776. We gave some bullet points this past Sunday. Sometimes I can be drinking from a fire hydrant, okay? I remember one time I was doing a conference, a business conference with Lance Wall now, and he's like, man, he's like, listening to you is like drinking from a fire hydrant. And I was like, join the club. And, because it's like two fire hydrants just shooting at each other. And so what I want to do is I want to pull apart some of these revelations that God is speaking to us for the coming year, because it's not just enough to know what God is desiring to do. It's really important to know how he wants to do it, to understand why he's looking to do it, so that we can partner with the process. Because how many of you know every promise has a process? Amen? It's rare that we're given a promise that doesn't require a process of walking into the land that has been promised. Amen? So, there's no microwave promises, no microwave prophecies. John 6:28, of course, was the scripture the Lord gave us for this when we shared 2 weeks ago during the Feast of Trumpets. And in John 6:28, Jesus is asked, he said, how can we do the works of God? How can we say the things you say? How can we do the things you do? In verse 29, he says, this is the work. This is the work of God, to believe on him whom God had sent. And what I want to speak to you tonight is believing and birthing. It's receiving a promise, it's conceiving a culture, and then it's believing what God has asked us to do and beginning to birth what he's called us to carry. Amen? But first, turn your Bible to Luke chapter 1, verses 11 through 20. And I know that they're going to put it up on the screen too. First, let's look at how not to birth. What do you say? Luke chapter 1, verses 11 through 20. I'm telling you, the Lord is so excited about what, not only what you've been called to carry, but also what you're about to birth. That's what this whole dream that I had about Dan was. I mean, there was just like, you know, and I saw Dan in the dream. I'm like, oh, great, Dan, what are you here to do? Boil water, cut sheets, you know? What are we doing, Dan? And he was just like, just beside himself, just rejoicing over what God was bringing forth in our midst, amen? And how many of you know we're in a season of birthing? We are in a season of birthing. We're in a season of birthing in the natural and in the spirit. Paul said in 1 Corinthians, he said, first in the natural, then in the spirit, amen? And so we're going to look at what not to do when it comes to birthing. Starting in verse 11 of Luke chapter 1. It says, an angel of the Lord appeared to him. By the way, him being Zechariah. Okay, Zacharias. The angel of the Lord appeared to him standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zechariah saw him, he was troubled and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, do not be afraid. You ever notice that's like angel 101. They always show up saying, do not be afraid. Sometimes folks are like, oh yes, I saw an angel tiptoeing through the tulips and he was breathing on the dandelions and populating the... I'm like, did you see an angel? Was that a figment of your imagination? Is that just something you wanted to see? Because when you really see an angel, when an angel really shows up, power comes with it. Amen? But he saw an angel. Angel appeared to him, standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zechariah saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell on him. But the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will also be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. He will also go before them in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. That's a great promise. That's a great promise. I mean, part of me just wants to go back and read that again because it's so awesome. The angel shows up and says, hey, Zach, here's the deal. I've heard your prayer. See, because he was actually, Elizabeth was barren. We know she was barren. And he was actually coming during his week in the temple, to serve in the temple. And as he was coming, you see this in the previous verses, he was carrying in his heart, in verse 7, it says, they had no child because Elizabeth was barren, and they were both well advanced in years. So it was while he was serving as priest before God in order of his division, according to the custom of the priesthood, that the lot fell to him to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And it says the whole multitude was praying outside of the temple, but as he walks into the temple, what is he carrying in his heart? A desire for a child. He's wanting a child, and his wife is barren. She doesn't have the ability to conceive and to bring forth what they have wanted their entire life. And it was interesting, Friday and even Sunday, the Lord is highlighting this birthing, breaking the power of barrenness, beginning to, and there's testimonies even right now that I wish I could share with you publicly, but they're a little medically detailed right now, and I'm not sure how to share it without it becoming an eighth grade health class. So when they're ready, they'll share it. But God is doing some things. He's putting things back. He's restoring innocence. He's restoring covenant. So it says all of these things about John. Great promise. How many of us have ever been given a great promise from God? Almost like, whew, that's too good to be true. Those are typically how you can tell it's God. And Zechariah said to the angel, how shall I know this? For I am an old man and my wife is well advanced in years. In other words, he started to speak against the promise before he really heard the promise. When he heard what God was wanting to do, all he could think about was how and why God couldn't really do what God had said he was about to do. And the angel answered and said to him, I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God and was sent to speak to you and to bring you these glad tidings. But behold, you'll be mute and not able to speak until the day that these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their own time or at their proper time. Poor Zach, struck mute. How many of you ever read this and like it was presented to you, maybe a Sunday school teacher or a pastor, just that this was like God's punishment for Zacharias? It wasn't God's punishment. It was his protection. It was actually the Lord's protection, provision, and preparation for Zacharias, because the Lord was so jealous over what John the Baptist was called to prepare the way for and to make ready the people for, that he was going to strike mute anyone who would try to speak a word against what he was about to do. And see, it may not be that you lose your natural voice, but I am telling you in the name of the Lord, the fear of the Lord that is resting upon us, the fear of the Lord that is resting not just in this place, it is not a season to speak against what God has promised. It is not a season to give doubt, fear, unbelief, or confusion a voice in your life or in the lives of those around you. Because words may come out, but the Lord will cause them to fall to the ground. How many of you have ever been talking to somebody and you really, man, you're like, I'm on a roll. You know, I'm talking. And then you recognize, like, somehow they've left the conversation and you're still talking. No. Anybody know what I'm talking about? That's a lot of times the Lord's protection. Or how many of you ever had this happen? This is always awesome. I always chuckle. You get ready to start telling somebody something on the phone that your heart says you really shouldn't tell. It could be defined as gossip, slander, even murmuring. And then, but you really want to share it because it's juicy. That's a good way to say it. Thank you, Sophia. It's juicy. Also demonic, but juicy. Just saying, the thing. Listen, listed among the things the Lord hates, those who sow discord among the brethren. Shaytay with a side of boomba. So, how many of you ever been trying to tell somebody something, and all of a sudden you lose your signal? You're like, I'm going to call them back. You try to call them back. I mean, like, it's not even a first attempt at gossip. It's like a second attempt. It's like, no, I'm bless God, I'm going to call an intercession meeting. I'm going to say this. We're And oftentimes, I want to tell you, those are those moments to say, huh. I love these phone calls. A lot of times somebody will be, hey, I really need to tell you, da, 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 and then the call drop. And then they'll call back, a call drop, and they'll say again, hey, listen, there's so much warfare against what I'm trying to say. I said, well, listen, do you think that is the enemy opposing what you're wanting to say because it's going to bring blessing in life to those you're speaking about? Or do you think it's the Lord actually protecting you and preserving you and providing for you and giving you a way out? And they're like, yeah, goodbye. It's a great way to reduce your calls. This is God's protection, provision, and preparation. It was not punishment. And the Lord was so jealous for what John the Baptist was called to prepare the way for. He was willing to strike mute anyone and everyone who would speak against what God had promised to do. And I just believe that God is getting ready to do this in our city, to where he is so jealous for what he has promised. And he is so jealous over those that he has positioned and prepared to prepare the way, that those who would try to speak doubt, unbelief, fear, and confusion, that he would cause their words to fall to the ground, producing nothing in the lives of those around them. But how many of you are thankful for second chances? Turn over to Luke chapter 1, verses 59 through 66. I want to show you how Zechariah got his voice back. Verse 59, it says, so on the eighth day, what does that speak of? New beginnings. They came to circumcise the child that they would have called him by the name of his father, Zacharias. His mother answered and said, no, he shall be called John. But they said to her, there is no one among your relatives who is called by his name. So they made signs to his father what he would have him called. And he asked for a writing tablet and wrote saying, his name is John. So they all marveled. Think about that, guys. 10 months. You can't talk, and you're just having to write on the tablet. Thank God for iPads, right? Writing on the tablet. And here's what happened. When he wrote, his name is John, they all marveled, and immediately his mouth was opened, and his tongue was loose, and he spoke and began to praise God. See, when Zacchaeus agreed with the promise of God, his voice was restored. And there are voices, spiritual voices in our city that have spoken against what God wants to do in times past and even presently. And the authority and the influence of their voice has been lost in the process. But as they begin to do a turnaround 180 and they begin to agree with what God has said and begin to speak to things as though they are and not as though they are not, all of a sudden we're going to see their voices restored. And a lot of people you used to hear about that you haven't heard about in a very long time, all of a sudden you're going to start hearing about them again, because God's going to restore their voice as they begin to get over their own offense, their own affliction, their own disappointment, and begin to agree with the word of the Lord in this life. Skip on over to Psalm Shikede Baba, Luke. I was in Psalms a lot today. Luke 1, 26. Just flip back, take a left. And for the sake of time, I'm going to give you these keys as we go. But the Lord, I was just studying this. I've been looking at this for a while. You know, birthing's kind of heavy on my heart right now. And so the Lord's been speaking to me about believing and birthing. And he highlighted to me 20 keys for us in receiving, believing, and birthing the prophetic promise. And we're going to look at these through just a few verses in Mary's life. And who knows what the name Mary means? Huh? Bitter's one definition. There's three definitions: bitter, rebellious, and with child. Wished for a child, excuse me. Bitter, rebellious, and wished for a child. Isn't that interesting? Bitter, rebellious, and wished for a child. This tells me that, like Mary, we all have a choice. We can either be bitter about where we've been and what's happened to us and become rebellious in the process, or we can begin to set our heart on what's been promised and contend for that promise until we see it come forth. The Hebrew origin of the word Mary actually means to strip, to rob, or to make bare. In other words, she would have been justified in her bitterness. By the way, I just want to honor, you know, Jeremy Myers, he drives 2.5 hours both ways, each way, to each and every one of these services. Is it what? Huh? Oh, 1.5. My bad. 1.5. Sorry, that evangelistic anointing came on me. 1.5. And I just want to tell you, listen, the Lord sees that hunger, and he honors that hunger. That's awesome. That's awesome. I don't know where I got 2.5. I don't know. You know, anybody else drive 2.5 hours? You know? Huh? Huh? You drive 1.5 too? Anybody else? Do I hear two? Anybody two? Two, 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 three, 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 four, 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 five, 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 six, six, six. Anybody live in the neighborhood and you're watching? Bam. All right. So again, Mary, the Hebrew origin means to strip or to rob. Again, she had a choice whether to be bitter and rebellious or to wish for the child that she had been promised. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. Shaka. I just saw this number 320. Does 320 mean anything to anybody here? 320. I know on Friday we started, the Lord started giving us numbers and they ended up being area codes, 320. That wasn't what it was Friday, but 320. It could be March 20th. It could be your birthday. It could be an anniversary. 320. I keep seeing 320. Three, two, zero, 320. If that speaks anything to you, if that is it'd be like a birth date, an anniversary, an area code, an address. If that's you, just come on up to my right here. I know one time, you know, Lord started giving us just different dates and started calling them out. And there was one date that didn't come up, and I think it was March 23rd. And I get a text from the director's suite that it was her parents' anniversary. And so oftentimes, a lot of times, it's something the Lord is speaking, and maybe somebody's not just in earshot, but 320. It's got a real promise for you. Well, maybe they'll end up coming by the end of the meeting. See anybody walk in late, tap and say, 320 mean anything to you? All right. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. It says, now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth. Now, who remembers what Nazareth means? Nazareth comes from, excuse me? That's right. It comes from the Greek word netzer, which means branch. And just saw the kids' door open up there. Maybe Dustin or Chris could go up there if 320 means anything to one of those kids. I've got a word for whoever this is, 320. So, but now in the sixth month, an angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. Again, we're looking at 20 keys for receiving, believing, and birthing prophetic promises. The first two we get from the life of Zechariah. Number one, don't speak against the promise. Don't question what God has promised to do and how God has promised to do it. The second thing we learn is do what God tells you to do. Do what God tells you to do. It didn't make sense to Zechariah, but how many of you know God had sent the angel to answer Zechariah's prayer? He sent the angel to answer Zechariah's prayer. And then all of a sudden, the answer shows up. And I want to tell you, listen, there are prayers that you have prayed that God is about to answer. And the answer is going to show up in a way that even may offend your mind. And it may be outside of what you thought God wanted to do or even what he was able to do in and through your life. But I'm telling you, if you'll embrace the answer, if you'll embrace the answer, and then not try to disqualify the answer to the prayer you prayed. A lot of times we don't like the package the gift of God comes in. A lot of times we're praying for years and years and years, and then all of a sudden God sends the answer to the prayer we've prayed, and maybe we don't like the package it comes in, the box it comes in. Has anybody, you know, just, you know, gotten a gift? And, you know, I mean, we do this all the time. You re-gift things. You know, you'll take something of value and you'll put it in some sort of cheap box, you know, like all of a sudden it's like a diaper genie box, but there's a diamond ring in it, you know. Again, diaper genie. We're in the birthing mind here. So there's like a diamond ring in the diaper. Somebody opens it up and goes, ah, diaper genie. Ah, okay. And they just begin to put it aside, never opening up the package to see the gift that's inside. So oftentimes that happens in prayer. We pray a prayer, God answers the prayer. We don't recognize or embrace or appreciate the package that the answer, the gift comes in. And so we begin to just push it aside, and we push away the package. And when we push away the package, we push away the gift. I want to tell you, it's a season to open up the package, to embrace the answer in whatever form it comes in. Amen? So two things we learn from Zechariah. Number one, don't speak against the promise. Two, do what God tells you to do. Now in verse 28, we see we start to see 18 things in the life of Mary of how to receive, believe, and birth the promise that God has given to us. The first thing that Mary was told to do, Jesus. Yes, Kyle, that scripture is connected to the word that I had for this person, but it wouldn't be just the scripture. Thanks for sending me that text, though. So, Kyle was like, I love Ephesians 3:20. I appreciate that. That was awesome. That's part of the promise. That's part of the prophecy. And shikarabunda. But anyway, Mary, the first thing we learned from Mary is that she was told to do what? To rejoice. She was told to rejoice. The first thing the angel said, angel having come in, the angel said to her, rejoice, highly favored one. The Lord is with you. It didn't say the Lord was with you. It didn't say the Lord will be with you. He said, rejoice, highly favored one. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. So the first thing that we're told to do in terms of receiving, believing, and birthing the prophetic promise is to begin to rejoice when the promise is given. Begin to rejoice. Begin to celebrate the hereness of God. The next thing we see in verse 30, we'll continue to read. It says, but when she, in verse 29, but when she saw him, she was troubled. That word troubled simply means disturbed at his saying and considered, what manner of greeting was this? Then the angel said to her, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. You have found favor with God. And so the second thing was to fear not. Say no to fear, to doubt, to confusion, and to unbelief. The third thing that she had to do, or the fifth thing overall, we see in verse 28 and again in verse 30, she had to see herself as favored. Angel shows up, and the first two sentences he speaks to her, he tells her twice, highly favored one. And see, one of the things that honestly, a lot of times we have trouble receiving, conceiving, believing, and birthing what God has asked us to carry because we don't see ourselves as valuable in the eyes of God or valuable in the eyes of others. She had to see herself as favored by God. Amen? How many of you know you're favored? Amen. Psalm 5:12 tells you, it says that he surrounds the righteous with favor as with a shield. Amen? He surrounds the, how many righteous here? Come on, he who knew no sin was made sin for you that you might become the righteous of God in Christ. This whole day, at one, atonement, cleansed, purged, reconciled, made one, made right. We are made righteous because of the blood of the Lamb. Amen? And as we are made righteous because of the blood of the Lamb, he surrounds you with favor as with a shield. In other words, when you walk into a job and you're going to interview for a position, you don't walk in with your need, you walk in going, man, I have all that heaven has to give. This place is going to be blessed if they hire me. I don't need them. They need me. Then when we walk into a store, we're not there just to meet our need. We're saying, listen, the kingdom of God has come near you. What you have, baby, I got it. Aretha Franklin, come on now. She had to see herself as favored. Verse 31 through 33, behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. So verses 31 through 33, we see the sixth key overall, receive, believe, and conceive the promise. First, you have to receive it. You can't reject it. You can't reject it. And honestly, I believe what God is asking us to do in this city didn't just believe 30 years ago, didn't just begin 30 years ago, but I believe it was something God has wanted to do for a very long time. But there was many, many different people, men and women, that had rejected for this and that what God was wanting to do and what he was asking to do in that season. And division got in, disappointment got in, deferment of hope got in. And then finally, the Lord started to find people who would say yes. They would start to find people who would say yes and to start to believe. And still there was delay. Amen? But oftentimes, people will reject the promise, they'll reject the invitation, and the first step there is to receive it, and then to believe it, and then to conceive it. Because he gives her this great word of who her son would be and what her son will do. Then verse 34, Mary said to the angel, she said, how can this be? I do not know a man. recognizing and receiving, conceiving and believing the, and birthing the prophetic promises of God, recognize that the promise is not dependent on human effort or energy. Recognize that the promise is not dependent on human effort or energy. She said, how can this be? I'm a virgin. I have not yet known a man. See, and it had nothing to do with who she had known and who had known her. It had to do with the fact that God had found a willing heart in Mary. Verse 35, we see the importance of making time for prayer, seeking God, and being filled up. Verse 35, it says, the angel answered and said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. The Holy Spirit. See, she's saying, how can this be? I can't do this. And here the angel is saying, Holy Spirit will come upon you. Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the highest will overshadow you. Therefore also that the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. So now the promise just went to a whole nother level. Holy Spirit will overshadow you. He'll come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Folks, I want to encourage you. I talked on Sunday about the importance of just taking some time during this Day of Atonement to get away with the Lord. But that was a trick. It was a trick to just try to get you to come away and to fall in love with what it looks like to come away, so that you won't just come away one day out of the year, but you'll come away every day out of the year and begin to look at it as your spiritual sustenance, and honestly begin to desire it more than the air you breathe, the drink you drink, the food you eat. But we'd really begin to start desiring the presence of the Lord and become a people of prayer, and in that become a people of power. I want to tell you the way that the Lord's been meeting with me in my office. Like I was telling Jeff, I was like, listen, you guys can go do the service. I just want to stay here and pray. I want to just be on the floor. I just want to, there was nothing in me that needed to preach or needed to share other than the fact of if somehow God could take what's on us and put it on you. That was the only thing. Like, I didn't want to do anything. Just pray. Just spend time with the Lord. And I'm telling you, if you'll begin to start giving your heart to the Lord, He'll begin to take what you give and pull you in closer. If you'll begin to get, just begin to give Him whatever room you make for Him, He will fill. Amen? Now it says the power of the Most High overshadowed her. What does overshadow mean? It simply means to cast a shadow over something. But if we want to be overshadowed by Holy Spirit, He doesn't throw His shadow. The shadow rests upon those who stand by Him, who stand by the Lord. In Zechariah 4, it talks about in verse 11 and 12, it talks about these two guys. It says they were the anointed ones, and in Hebrew it means sons of fresh oil. And it talked about just all of this beautiful imagery about these gold pipes and these receptacles and these bowls that were filling up with the oil, it's just a great picture that is painted in Zechariah 4, 11 and 12. But in verse 12, this is the description it gives of these two sons of fresh oil, these two anointed ones. It says, these were those who stood by the Lord. And so I'm like, yes, that's awesome, golden pipes. Yes, that's awesome, bowls. Yes, that's awesome, oil. But how did they get it? That was all the fruit. What was the root? They stood with the Lord. They stood before the Lord, and they stood with the Lord. And folks, I'm telling you, that is the invitation that God is giving to us, to stand with the Lord, to stand with the Lord, to stand before the Lord, and to be as God in this city. I'm not saying that you become Christ. I'm not saying people hear that being as God, and they get weird. They get weird. Ever heard anybody get weird? He told Moses, he said, listen, you'll be as God to Pharaoh. In other words, he's saying, I'm going to be so with you that when you speak, it'll be like I spoke. Psalm 82, same thing. He says, are you not all gods? John 10:34, Jesus stands up, and when they're beginning to question who He is and beginning to question Him as the Son of God, He said, are you not all gods? You claim Abraham as your father, but do you not know your history? Do you not know the promise, the invitation that you've been given? You were created in the image of God. You're created in the likeness of God. Live like it. Because God is looking for a people that He can put His authority on. He's looking for a people that He can put His weight in their words. But He can't just put it on a people who have claimed His name without the cultivating of His nature. And it's in prayer, and it's in that place of being overshadowed. It's in that place of the Holy Spirit coming upon us that we become like Christ. And we begin to conceive, and we begin to believe in what we've been called to carry. Verse 35, again, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. This is speaking the fact that it's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by my Spirit. Verse 36, you see the importance of feeding yourself with testimonies of what God has done for others. Verse 36, it says, "Now indeed Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren." And so in other words, the angel is showing up. This is such an awesome angelic interaction. The angel shows up, gives her an amazing promise, and honestly, you know, the prophecy to Zechariah was actually a little bit more detailed than the prophecy to Mary. But he stands up and he begins to start giving her this word, and she's like, "Well, how can this be? I'm not yet known a man." He goes, "Oh, and by the way, you remember your cousin who was barren? She's not anymore, because we came to her too." And there's something about feeding yourself with testimonies about what God has done for others that then begins to impart hope and hunger to your heart for what God wants to do for you. I want to read you something. This is called The Miracle Under the Thorn Tree. This is, again, John G. Lake, Spiritual Hunger. He said, "I love to tell this story because it is a story of a hungry man. A short time after I went to South Africa and God had begun to work very marvelously in the city of Johannesburg, a butcher who lived in the suburbs was advised by his physicians that he had developed such a tubercular state that he might not live more than 9 months. He wanted to make provisions so that his family would be cared for after he was gone. He bought a farm and undertook to develop it so that when he died, his family would have a means of existence. One day he received a letter from friends at Johannesburg telling of the coming of what they spoke of as the American Brethren and of the wonderful things that were taking place. They told of so-and-so, a terrible drunkard who had been converted, of his niece who had been an invalid in a wheelchair for 5 years, who had been healed of God. How one of his other relatives had been baptized in the Holy Ghost and was speaking in tongues." These are letters about people in his family, people that he knew that were being dramatically touched by God. "Of other friends and neighbors who had been baptized and healed, he told of the powerful change that had come in the community and all the marvels of a vigorous work for God produces. Dan von Vuren took the letter and crawled under an African thorn tree. He spread the letter out before God and began to discuss it with the Lord. He said, 'God in heaven, if you could come down to Mr. So-and-so, a drunkard, and deliver him from his sin and save his soul and put the joy of God in him, if you could come to this niece of mine, save her soul, heal her body, and send her out to be a blessing instead of a weight and burden upon her friends, if you could come to so-and-so and they were baptized in the Holy Ghost and spoke in tongues, then Lord, if you can do these things at Johannesburg, you can do something for me too.' He knelt down, put his face to the ground, and cried to God that he would do something for him. That morning, von Vuren was so stirred by the reading of the letter." What did the Lord say this morning was? That we're in a season, a stirred up season. "He was so stirred by the reading of that letter that his desire to be made whole got bigger than anything else in his consciences. His heart reached for God, and that morning his prayer went through to heaven. God came down in his life. In 10 minutes, he took all the breath he wanted. The pain was gone, the tuberculosis had disappeared, and he was a whole man." That's awesome, but it gets better. It says that was not all. He not only received a great physical healing, but God also had literally come in and taken possession of the man's life until he did not understand himself anymore. And telling me, he said, "Brother," I like that, "brother, a new prayer from heaven," "a new prayer from heaven was born in my spirit. I had prayed for my wife's salvation for 18 years, but I never could pray through. But that morning I prayed through. It was all done when I got to the house. She stood and looked at me for 2 minutes until it dawned in her soul that I was gloriously healed of God. She never asked a question as to how it took place, but fell on her knees, threw her hands up to heaven, and said, 'Pray for me, Dan. For God's sake, pray for me. I must find God today.' And God came into her soul." Von Vuren had 11 splendid children. The mother and he began praying. Within a week, the whole household of 13 had been baptized in the Holy Ghost. He went to his brother's farm, told of the wonder that God had done, prayed through. I love that, prayed through. He didn't just pray a prayer and go on. He persisted in prayer. He prayed through. And in a little while, 19 families were baptized in the Holy Ghost. Revival in the South African Parliament. See, look, God touched this little butcher. healed him of tuberculosis, and God didn't stop there. And one of the things about a birthing is it's not just about what you birth, it's about everything that is affected by what you birth. You know, one of the things that we're doing now is we're beginning to recognize, as we prepare the nursery, we're beginning to recognize all of the changes that are going to come to our family and to this family with this birth, our natural birth as well as a spiritual birth. Because it's not just about the birthing of an individual, it's about everything changes with every birth. And oftentimes what you find in your heart is more love than you knew you had. So revival in the South African Parliament. So here he was, a butcher with tuberculosis. He gets a letter about what God is doing in another place in the world, Johannesburg. And then all of a sudden, he begins to say, wait a minute, God, if you did it for them, you'll do it for me because you're no respecter of persons, Acts 10:34. And he begins to pray that way. He begins to get hungry for God. And then all of a sudden, he gets his healing. And then he's like, wait a minute, I'm going to roll. I'm going to pray for my sister. She gets saved. And then all of a sudden, they don't stop there. I want to tell you, that's a key to revival, is don't stop there. When you're on a roll, go for the jugular. It's a revival in the South African Parliament, because what God is wanting to do is he's wanting to take average people who have been afflicted with various diseases and infirmities and sickness and begin to touch them with the goodness of God that not only heals them but restores their families and then begins to set them before kings and priests. Just like he did in Isaiah chapter 60. It says, God so filled von Buren's life with his glory that one morning God said to him, go to Pretoria. You know what I love about this? It says he went to his brother's farm, told of the wonder that God had done, prayed through, and in a little while 19 families were baptized. He arose and he shone. He didn't wait for people to come to him. He didn't sit back and watch it online. It says he went, he told, he testified, then he prayed through, and Holy Spirit began to pour himself out. Friends, I'm telling you, there's a go of the gospel that we have to have. Yes. Matthew chapter 10, verse 7, he says, freely you receive, freely you've received, freely give. Go. 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 Preach the gospel, heal the sick, cast out devils, raise the dead. He didn't just say, come. Jesus stood up on the last day of the feast, said, if anybody's thirsty, let them come to me and drink, and then out of their heart will flow rivers. See, we come here out of our thirst, but we go out of the command. In other words, we recognize, I'm thirsty for the Lord. I'm thirsty for his presence. I'm thirsty for coming together and just celebrating what God is doing. I'm going to come and I'm going to receive so that the rivers in my heart can be unlocked, and then I'm going to go out into the streets and begin to give away what I've got. I'm going to begin to go to the Whistle Stop Festival, and my God, if there's 7,000 people, that's the opportunity for 7,000 salvations. Are you with me? That we begin to start living to plunder hell and populate heaven. Jesus. God so filled von Buren's life with his glory that one morning God said to him, go to Pretoria. I'm going to send you to the different members of parliament. At executive headquarters, he was admitted to the presence of Premier Louis Both. Both told me about it afterwards. This is John G. Lake talking. Premier Both said, Lake, I had known von Buren from the time he was a boy. I had known him as a reckless, rollicking fellow, but that man came into my office and stood 10 feet from my desk, and I looked up before he began to speak, and I began to shake in my chair. I knelt down. I had to stick my head under the desk and cried to God. Why, he looked and talked like God. He had the majesty of God upon his life, and he was superhumanly wonderful. Wow. One man got hungry. Von Buren then went to the office of the Secretary of State. I like it. He's just going door to door, just knocking on offices. That's awesome. Go for the jugular. Von Buren then went to the office of the Secretary of State, then to the Secretary of the Treasury. Almost the same thing took place in each instance. For 18 days, God kept him going from this one to that one. Lawyers, judges, and officials in the land. He was a butcher. He wasn't even a baker or a candlestick maker. He was a butcher. For 18 days, God kept him going from this one to that one, lawyers, judges, and officials in the land, until every high official. What if this is how God wants to change our government? What if this is how God wants to get a hold over the heart of our nation? What if this is how God wants to bring revival in America, and all of a sudden an uprightness where political correctness has stripped and made bare the systems that God has given to us to govern this nation as united under God? until every high official in the land knew there was a God, a Christ, and a Savior, and a baptism of the Holy Ghost, because Dan von Buren had really hungered after God. Blessed are they which do hunger. For several years after I left Africa, he went up and down the land like a burning fire. Everywhere he went, sinners were saved, sick were healed, men and women were baptized in the Holy Ghost until he set the outlying districts on fire with the power of God. See, when Mary questioned, the angel had to give a testimony. And so when we begin to question about what God wants to do in our city, we need to begin to look at what God has done in other cities and begin to recognize, wait a minute, God, you're no respecter of persons. I'm putting your remembrance of your word. These are the promises you've given to us. And if you did it for John G. Lake, you're going to do it for us. If you did it for Dan von Buren under a thorn tree, he didn't even have a service, didn't even have a prayer cloth, just a letter that a family member had written. It wasn't even from the anointed man of God. It was just from somebody who had received from God, and they had to tell somebody about it. I'm telling you, listen, don't ever hold back your testimony. The testimony of Jesus, the spirit of prophecy. Honestly, and I've talked about it since I came here, I see in the days ahead, our Sundays would just be testimony days. We're holding up wheelchairs, we're holding up crutches, we're holding up braces, we're holding up this and that. We're talking of we're bringing the spoils. You know, you didn't get to see the video announcement for tonight, but I told him, I said, listen, just start talking about how Wednesday night's equipping, Friday night's for fire, healing, miracle, spirit of revival, and Sunday is just to celebrate what God is doing in and through your life. If we have to keep coming back every Sunday and getting the same things broken off every Sunday, something is wrong with our Monday through Saturday.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
If we're continuing to come and to break through, but then we go back and we lose the same battles week in, week out, what are we doing? If we come needing prayer for the same things every Sunday, and I'm all about praying through. I'm about praying through. But gosh darn it, pray through. Pray through. And then go tell somebody what God has done for you. And I'd like to offer to you that oftentimes the reason why breakthrough doesn't stick is because we don't tell anybody about it. Because it's oftentimes doubt, unbelief, fear, and confusion that invites the affliction back upon us. And we have more of an expectation in the enemy to put sickness on us than for God to set us free. So verse 36, this is the 10th key. In birthing, it's too hard saying all those evings: receiving, conceiving, believing, birthing. We're just going to call it believing and birthing. Feed yourself with the testimonies of what God has done for others. Verse 37. Remind yourself of who is at work in your situation. Verse 37 says, "For with God, nothing will be impossible." Say that with me. For with God, nothing will be impossible. This is how the Amplified says it. It says, for with God, nothing is ever impossible, and no word from God shall be without power or impossible of fulfillment. The NIV says this. It says, now I'm not big on the NIV, but I do like this because of how they translated the word nothing. It says, for no word from God will ever fail. That's straight and to the point. No word from God will ever fail. Because you know the word nothing, when it says that nothing is impossible for God, the word nothing literally means no word, no rhema. In other words, the rhema of God, the word of God has enough power resonant within it to bring to pass whatever it's been sent to release. That's why in Isaiah 55 it says that the word of the Lord will not return to him void, but it will accomplish what he sent it to do and prosper in that place. Amen? So you have to remind yourself, who is at work in your situation? What's impossible with man is possible with God. Amen? What the Lord spoke to us this past Friday that we still haven't had a chance to preach, maybe Friday, maybe Sunday, we'll see, is only believe. And honestly, I was telling Jeff this morning, that message is growing in my heart. It's like this burning ember. And I even asked the Lord today, I said, Lord, are we supposed to release that tonight? He said, no, it's not ready yet. It's not ready yet. Only believe. Because I'm telling you, the Lord's about to do things in and through your life that everyone around you would try to say was impossible. And the invitation is only believe, because he is the one who does it. It's not by your might. It's not by your power. It's by his spirit, says the Lord. Verse 38, this is honestly probably one of the most important, and it's something that everybody here I know has done. Say yes. Yeah. Say yes. Yes is the prayer prayed by hungry hearts. Verse 38, Mary said, behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be unto me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. In other words, the angel wouldn't leave until he got yes for an answer. Yes is a prayer of surrender. Yes is a prayer of hunger. Yes is a little word that opens big doors. Verses 39 through 42, surround yourself. This is so important. I got to walk away. It's that important. Surround yourself with people who celebrate what you carry. All the way up until now, these first 12 points were all about you. And honestly, these first 12 points, most of us check these in our prophecy box, in our checklist box. We receive it. We believe it. Bless God. We check it out. We say yes. And this is oftentimes where the enemy gets in. This is oftentimes where the snake finds itself in our grass. Surround yourself with people who celebrate what you carry. Verses 39 through 42, it says, Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste to a city of Judah and entered the house of Zacharias and greeted Elizabeth. And it happened when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary that the babe leapt in her womb and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Listen, how many times have we read this scripture and there is so much fresh life, there is so much manna, there is so much oil on this passage. It happened when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary that the babe leapt in her womb and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And we don't have the time to really preach this tonight. We're just having to give bullet point keys. But I want to encourage you to go back and ruminate, marinate, begin to go back and chew on this passage and say, God, make me pregnant. Make me pregnant. Make me hungry. Make me thirsty. It happened when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary that the babe leapt in her womb and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Then she spoke out with a loud voice and said, blessed are you among women and blessed is the fruit of your womb. Surround yourself with people who celebrate what you carry. She walked in, opened her mouth, and all of a sudden Elizabeth was like, ho, kata, ha, ha, hey, hey, whoo, ha, hey, hey, blessed are you. And see, listen, if you don't have people in your life that get like that when you walk in the door, you need to get some new friends. If you have people that when you walk in, they're like, oh, it's just you. Let that be the last time you walk in that room. We need people who do not just tolerate us, but celebrate us. Because honestly, they're as much a part of the birthing process of what we've been called to carry as we are. She walks in, Elizabeth hears Mary's voice, and she's like, oh! I mean, when was the last time somebody got filled with the Holy Ghost and their baby just simply with a hello? She greeted, and Holy Ghost was like, boom. You know why? Because it wasn't the word that he was anointing. It was the agreement. It was the agreement. The next key is look for an agreement and a witness between what you have been called to carry or what you have conceived and what you have been promised to birth and what those around you are carrying in this season. There's the agreement, the witness. It's like the kingdom carry. Where when you begin to find the leap of the Lord when what you're called to walks into the room. And it can be just you and them in the room. There's no report of it being anybody else. It wasn't a large service. It wasn't a revival meeting. There's no promotion. It was just Mary walked in pregnant with the Lord, and Elizabeth was there pregnant with John the Baptist. Mary said hello, and God showed up. Verse 43, 15th key. I love this. Well, back up to verse 42. She spoke out with a loud voice and said, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. That was awesome. She just started prophesying right out of the gate because of this agreement and this witness she had found in the Spirit. Verse 43, says, this is Mary. But why is this granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For indeed, as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, the babe leapt in my womb. Verse 43, stay humble. Why is this granted me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Stay humble in the process. As you begin to recognize what you're called to carry, humility is what actually gets you through the contractions. Verse 44, for indeed, as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, the babe leapt in my womb. Blessed is she who believed. Blessed is she who believed. Blessed is she who, for there will be fulfillment of those things which were told her from the Lord. Here's a blessing on believing. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst. You don't hunger unless you believe there's more. You don't thirst unless you believe there's more. There's a blessing on those who believe. She had to look for an agreement, a witness. There's power in agreement. How can two walk together unless they agree? Amos 3:3. Matthew 18:18 through 19 says, "Surely I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven." That word agree in the Greek is symphoneo. It's a symphony of many instruments coming together as one sound. It is the new sound of worship that is about to spring forth. It's not just about many people singing one song off a thing. It's about all of a sudden when many hearts can come together to form one voice. Verse 44, we see the importance of beginning to give a voice to what you've been promised. Beginning to give a voice. She said, "For indeed, as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, the babe leapt in my womb." And she began to give a voice to what she'd been promised and what she'd been created to carry. All of a sudden, John the Baptist began to respond and Elizabeth. But when Mary spoke, my question is, what did Elizabeth hear? What did she feel? What was released when the breath of the Holy Spirit and Christ inside Mary was given a voice? It's the original Christ in you. She was the original Christ in you. What did she hear? What did she feel that all of a sudden calls her to begin to start prophesying? "Blessed are you among women. Blessed is the fruit of your womb." And my next question is, what is it in you that God is desiring this church, your family, your business, this city, to hear, to see, and to feel? When the voice, when the breath of the Holy Spirit has an opportunity to begin to speak through your voice and begin to resurrect the Christ in you, and begin to resurrect the hope to where you begin to believe again, you begin to receive again, and you begin to conceive again. Again, verse 45, believing releases a blessing. The blessing is in believing, and believing is a choice. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst. You won't hunger and thirst for more if you don't believe that there is more. Luke chapter 2, verse 19, of course, references the fact that Mary, even after the Lord's birth, she pondered all that had been promised in her heart. And she birthed in the Spirit before the fulfillment of what she had been promised. Remember, 30 years old, Jesus is at that wedding in Cana, and she goes up to him and she says, "Wait a minute, I've been carrying a promise in my heart for 30 years. I'm tired of waiting." She had, for 30 years, she had been pondering, dreaming, ruminating, talking to herself about this angelic encounter that would have been promised, because up until that, all he had done was make some tables and chairs and teach a few scribes in the temple. And see, we are like Mary. We've been waiting 30 years for what has been promised. But it's the pondering in the heart. It's keeping those things alive in your heart and not letting them die. Keeping those things alive in your heart and saying, "God, you said, and I have not yet seen. And I'm going to keep saying that you said until I see." Pondering contends for and births the manifestation of what you've been promised. Verses 46 and verse 47, it says, "Mary said, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit is rejoiced in God my Savior." So we have to see that the strength in birthing is to praise the Lord and to keep on praising. Lastly, verse 57 and 58, it says, "Now Elizabeth's full time came for her to be delivered, and she brought forth a son. When her neighbors and relatives heard how the Lord had shown great mercy to her, they rejoiced with her." The last key is to rejoice with those who rejoice. When others are showing the signs of pregnancy in the spirit, when others are showing the signs of contractions, when others are showing the signs of delivery, we don't look and go, "I wish I was like them." Have you ever seen this? Like, I hear it happens with women sometimes, not of course in the kingdom, but when people say, like, they see somebody get pregnant, they're like, "I wish I could be pregnant." And honestly, that happens a lot in the spirit. People actually begin to resent what you carry because they don't have it. Where if they would honor it, they would receive it. I've had people tell me that it offends them of how hungry and passionate and just how quickly I can break down when it comes to the things of the Lord. And I'm like, "Sorry, not sorry. Like, I don't care. Like, you know, I'm not here to make you happy. I'm here to love him." Amen? And because people, they're like, "Man, what, you know, why do you have to be like that? Can't you just be more put together?" Yes, I did. I was. It didn't work. This is how I am. This is who I am. This is how God made me to be. I can put it all together. We can put it on. Da, 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 da. It's not, and I'll tell you, that's not the Lord. It's not the Lord for me. And so oftentimes what is outside of our norm is uncomfortable and we reject it. And instead of saying, "Lord, can I find the comforter in what is uncomfortable?" So real quickly, just as a review, I'm not going to give you the scriptures. I just spit it out bullet point, but I wanted to unpack this. The first word that God gave us at the Feast of Trumpets for releasing this out for the coming year is this year of believing and birthing. 20 keys for receiving, conceiving, believing, and birthing prophetic promise. Number one, don't speak against the promise. Don't question what God has promised to you and how God has promised to do it. Two, do what God tells you to do. Three, rejoice. And again, I say rejoice. Celebrate the here-ness of God. Celebrate the here-ness of God. God with us. Emmanuel, God is with us. When Mary was told to rejoice, what did the angel say? He says, rejoice, for the Lord is with you. He didn't say the Lord was. He doesn't say the Lord will be. He said, the Lord is with you. Emmanuel, God with us. And the more we have an awareness of God, the more we have a consciousness of God with us, the more revival will be drawn to us instead of us seeking revival. Fourth, fear not. Say no to fear, doubt, confusion, and unbelief. Five, see yourself as favored. Six, receive, believe, and conceive the promise. Agree with what God is saying. Seven, recognize that the promise is not dependent on human effort or energy. Eight, make time for prayer, seeking God, and being filled up. Nine, recognize it's not by your might, not by your power, but by the Spirit. Begin to put the emphasis on what the Holy Spirit is wanting to do in your life and not what you can accomplish for yourself. 10, feed yourself with testimonies of what God has done for others. 11, remind yourself who is at work in your situation. 12, say yes. Say yes. Whatever it is, whatever the promise is, yes is the prayer prayed by hungry hearts. 13, I can't say it enough, surround yourself with people who celebrate what you carry. 14, stay humble. 15, look for an agreement and a witness between what you have been called to carry or what you have conceived, what you have been promised to birth, and those around and what those around you are carrying in this season. 16, begin to give voice to what you have been promised. 17, believing releases a blessing. The blessing is in believing. 18, never stop pondering the promise. Pondering contends for and bursts the manifestation of what you have been promised. 19, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Come on now. 20, rejoice with those who rejoice. Find those who God is breaking through in their life and just praise yourself into a fit. Get yourself, get out of yourself and get into the kingdom. I love you so much. I love you so much. But honestly, I love where you're going a whole lot more than where you are. Amen. And you have to have people in your life who are willing to, they see what you're called to carry, and they can celebrate where you're going a whole lot more than where you've been, and they're not willing to tolerate you where you are. Yeah. Just say, come on, get up, let's go, come on, arise, shine, come on, your lights come, come on, the glory of the Lord's upon you, get up, go, come on. We got places to go, we got miracles to do, we got souls to save, dead to raise. Are you with me? But it's not a pill that I can give you. It's not a magical prayer. Because the Lord comes to each of us just like Mary and gives us a choice, whether to become bitter because of what's been stolen from us and to become rebellious in the moment and begin to reject the promise of God, or to say, you know what? I wish, I believe, I dream, and I contend for what you've promised. Jeff, why don't you come on up? We got 3 minutes to contend. By the way, you know, I know we're going, you know, Sundays we're going a little later, Wednesdays we're going a little later, Fridays we've gone a little later, but you know what? Honestly, what he wants to give is a whole lot more important than where you need to go. And we're in a season that we can't try to fit God in a box. I'm just telling you. I love you. I love him more. I love to keep everybody where they're all excited and they're happy, but at the same time, does any of that really matter if we don't have him? This whole church exists to be a resting place for God, to build him a house. not to be a church for a bunch of people. That's going to happen. Yeah, that'll happen. In the Lord's time and by his hand. But we're called to be a resting place. We're called to be a house built for the Lord himself. We're called to be a house that God wants to call home. And that's what I signed to give my life for. That's what I go to bed dreaming about. That's what I get up yearning for and praying into. That's what puts me on the floor under my desk. Because I know there's more. Because he wouldn't have put this hunger in my heart for more of him if he didn't want to give me more. He wouldn't tease me. He's shown me too much in too many other places to not believe that what he's done in other places he wants to do here. Answering that prayer we prayed at the beginning. A prayer of desperation, a prayer of hunger, saying, God, listen, if you'll give me your fire, I'll burn. A prayer saying, God, I just want to be hungrier than I've ever been, thirstier than I ever thought. I'm not looking for a church box I can check. I'm looking for a God I can walk with. Looking for a Jesus that can behold and become light. History and throughout scripture, you can see when the Lord would draw near cities just to see if there were hungry hearts there that desired he would stay, or if there were hungrier hearts in the next city, because he went where he was celebrated. So, well, didn't Jesus go everywhere? He didn't stay a lot of places long. But there were certain places like Capernaum where it said Jesus actually made his home. Because of the honor that they had for him there, the love that they had, the desire they had for him. And we're in a season of the Lord drawing near to awaken our hearts to the fact that he's here. To see, can he find faith in the earth? Can he find hunger? Can he find those hearts? Say, Lord, I want what you have to give more than what I've had and what I have. Because throughout scripture, throughout history, you see that the Lord would go places and there'd be good services. people would get healed and people would hear things that were encouraging to their hearts. It was kind of like a conference. And then they were content to go back to the way that they lived. They were content to go back to life as usual. And so he would just go on to the next city. Birmingham. The Lord's looking for Dan Von Buren's. People who begin to take and go, listen, if God's doing this there, God's going to do it here. People who won't take no for an answer, but believe that God is greater. He's greater than cancer. He's greater than HIV/AIDS. He's greater than every sickness, every infirmity. He's the God of more than enough. I mean, he is the antidote. He's the prescription. He is the all in all. Dustin just texted me that the car that Jeremy just bought is it's a C320. Okay. And see, everything the Lord's been speaking, even on Sunday, was about new ministry. You weren't here Sunday because you were sick. But it was about new ministry vehicles that are being released with these keys. And so you're actually in a season right now of the Lord not only establishing His identity to you, but also His identity in you, that He can begin to release His identity through you. And the vehicle that He has given you to do this is a 320, but it's a promise that you will see Ephesians 3:20. The C320, it's a play on words, that you will see that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above what you asked or thought, according to the power that is at work in you. And the truth is that your prayer had grown weary when you began to come here, and you're actually contemplating the stopping of praying prayers and the quitting altogether. But God is saying, I've given you a new vehicle. I've given you new keys. I've given you a new family. I've given you a new place. I've given you a place to prosper, a place to be sown, and a place to grow. And in that, He is able to do exceedingly abundantly above what you can ask or think, according to the power of God that is at work in you. And I just want to speak over each and every one of you. Just stand up right now. I want to speak for a release of 320 vehicles. C320, that this would be the year that we would see 320. We would see Ephesians 3:20. We would see Ephesians 3:20. We would see that God is able. He only needs a people who will ask, a people who will dream, a people who will imagine, a people who will think, a people who will believe with God and partner with God. He's looking for those who will come to Him in hunger, asking, praying, seeking, knocking, that we would see Ephesians 3:20 fulfilled in our midst. Is turning green. Those of you who have been at red lights, you've been in a position called stop, not even a yield or proceed, but you feel like you've been stopped, you've been stuck. The light is turning green. The word of the Lord is go, 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 go. Heal the sick, cast out devils, raise the dead. Freely you have received, freely give. I'm telling you, there's a multiplication. We begin to give away what we've got, it'll begin to increase in our lives and throughout the life of our city. Birmingham is meant to be ablaze, but God is looking for the right matches. God is looking for those who say, Lord, strike me. Lord, let me be a match. Lord, let me be one struck in such a way as to ignite the hearts of the hungry. It's a green light. You have a go from God to bring the kingdom everywhere you are and everywhere you go. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for each and every person here, those watching by way of the web tonight, in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, I'm asking for you to give what it is not in my power to give, it is not in my power to do, to make us hungry. God, I know what you've done in my heart. God, I know what you're doing in the heart of our staff and in our leadership, and I ask that that oil would flow freely throughout this body. God, I ask that all hindrances to hunger and thirst would be removed in the name of Jesus, and the oil of hunger and thirst would flow freely in and through this house in the name of the Lord Jesus, because I'm telling you, with God, anything is possible. Nothing is impossible to God. Nothing. And I'm telling you, it's time to get doubt, unbelief, fear, and confusion out of your garden. And just become, I'm telling you, when God and that thing in God that you're desiring becomes the highest place of your consciousness, the highest place of the affection of your heart, you will have what you believe. You set it before you. You got to set it before you. You got to keep looking at it. You got to keep every day waking up. Every day I wake up, I don't look at my calendar. I don't look at my schedule. I wake up and I look at the Lord and I remind myself of why we're here. I put it before me. What is this birth? What does a move of God look like that eye hasn't seen, ear hasn't heard? What would it look like for God to have a revival where Jesus was the star? What would it look like for the Lord to really be lifted up and draw all men to him? What would that look like? I wake up thinking about it. I go to bed thinking about it. I dream about it. When other people are eating, that's what I'm thinking, I'm praying into. God, what could it look like? What would it sound like? And I'm telling you, that's the power that's at work within each and every one of us. God is just looking for those who will ask, think, dream, and believe. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask for every person here, God, Lord, for you to baptize us in hunger. We need a revival of hunger. Baptize us in hunger. Baptize us in thirst. In Jesus' name I pray. Pickle us real good. You know, the first mention of the word baptism wasn't even in Scripture. It was in a recipe for making pickles. A guy named Nicanor. And it was in Nicanor's recipe for making pickles. And what happened was you would take a cucumber and you would boil it. You get it soft, you get it tender. And then it says you baptismo the cucumber in the vinegar until it came out a dill. God is wanting to do a baptism in your life that doesn't change who you are, but it does change what you taste like. Because listen, you open a jar of pickles, man, everybody comes running. God is wanting to baptize us. He's wanting to turn up the fire in our life to make us tender in such a way that he could baptize us and immerse us to where what we're in gets in us and we can carry that flavor and the reality and the sensation to the world. Baptize us, God. Baptize us in hunger. Baptize us in fire. Baptize us in the Holy Spirit.
Spirit of God, a fool in this place.
Yes, Lord. God, we ask for there to be a stirring within our hearts individually and collectively. Lord, that we would not be numbered among those in Isaiah 64:7 that you said that you couldn't find one to stir up themselves to lay hold of you. Father, Lord, let us be a people that would stir ourselves up, Lord, to recognize the nearness and hereness of God, that we would begin to embrace and begin to recognize the season of our visitation. Lord, that we begin to yea and amen what you're desiring to do in and through our lives, God. Father, our lives are laid bare before you, Lord. God, I just thank you for every promise that you've given to this city. Thank you for every promise that you've given to every person here and every promise you've given to this church. Lord, I ask that you'd give us the wisdom, the insight, the understanding, and the divine knowledge to be able to say yes and to be able to run with the baton that you've asked us to carry in this season. Lord, I ask that you begin to start gripping hearts with hunger. Make us hungry for you. Make us thirsty for you. Make us desperate for you, God. Lord, let there be like a righteous conviction, a godly sorrow that produces the fruits of repentance that begins to start sweeping throughout your churches. Lord, let the Dan Von Burens begin to rise up. People who are tired of how it's been. Say, there's got to be more. Lord, give us that type of authority, God. Give us that type of hunger that we could pray those kind of prayers, that we could be anointed and mantled like that. When he talked, it was like God was talking. Lord, you would take someone out of obscurity and you'd put them before Parliament and before Secretary of Treasurers and Secretary of State. And everybody from the king to the cow would repent and come into the kingdom. God, I ask in the name of Jesus, those that are hearing the sound of my voice and those who are watching my way of the web, those who call Kingsway Church their home, Lord, I ask in the name of Jesus for you to begin to release dreams even tonight of encouragement, of confirmation, and excitement about what you're about to do in this city. God, I thank you that when we say yes, we simply agree with the yes you've already said. And I thank you that you've said yes to Birmingham. You've said yes to Kingsway Church. You've said yes to every family represented here. So we say like Mary, let it be unto us according to your word. In Jesus' name. I'm going to give an opportunity for folks to continue to pray and to press in. I also want to remind you about the sign-up sheet at the Connect Center for the Whistle Stop Festival outreach this Saturday, 10 a.m. to 7. Be sure to sign up. Let us know when you can be there. And let's have just an awesome time loving our city and giving them Jesus.